On the crisp Friday morning of July 8th, 2022, Canadians across the nation awoke with their usual routines in mind, checking their feeds to see what they missed out on overnight. But something was amiss. Their internet was down. No problem, it was probably just the router acting up or something. It'll fix itself in a few minutes. An hour later, it was time to book an Uber to get to work, but the internet was still down. No problem, looks like some will just need to take the bus for the first time since the pandemic started. Upon getting to work, the employees seem to be a bit more idle than usual. What's going on, someone asks. Well, Rogers, our internet provider, is down, so we're just playing ping pong until they restore service. Yeah, but given the severity, it's probably gonna get fixed anytime now. Okay, bro, stop talking, it's your serve. Haha, buddy, you asked for it. Little did they know, they would be playing table tennis for the next 15 hours. During this time, not only was the internet down, but 911 calls failed for phones using Rogers' mobile service. Debit card transactions nationwide failed due to Interac's dependency on Rogers and Canada's dependency on a single company to handle every debit card transaction. Other banking services were impacted, Toronto's public infrastructure experienced various issues, airlines were delayed, and pop star The Weeknd announced that his tour stop at the Rogers Centre Stadium had to be postponed. Eventually, Rogers made it known that the outage was due to a server upgrade of some sort, and that they were working as quickly as possible to restore service. But due to the nature of these types of outages where literally everything is down, including access to internal debugging systems, progress was slow. Employees had to connect through alternate networks and travel physically to centralized locations. By the afternoon, the service had been down for over 12 hours with no indication of when it would be fixed. Throughout the day, some stores continued to only accept cash, and many crowded into public cafes offering free Wi-Fi on other networks. Finally, around 7 p.m. in the evening, Rogers began to see recovery. For context, the Canadian's telecommunications market is dominated by three key operators called the Big Three: Rogers, which we are talking about today, Bell, and TELUS. Kind of like AT&T, Verizon, and T-Mobile here in the States, or 中国移动, 中国联通, and 中国电信 in China. Huh, I guess it's always three. Anyways, over 12 million Canadians lost wireless and wireline services for basically the entire day. In response, the CEO made two commitments: to fully understand the root cause, and to apply a credit to affected customers, which turned out to be the equivalent of 5 days of service. Today, I'd like to make two similar commitments to you, to help you understand the root cause, and to give you the opportunity to slap that like button. So suppose my home used Rogers internet and I wanted to connect to Fortnite. Let's take a look at the network architecture using the standard three-layer model. First, we hit the access layer, the initial point of contact between me and Rogers' network. This would be the sick new mesh router system I just installed, and the fiber cable that connects the router to the second layer, the distribution layer. This layer consists of everything between my house and the final core layer. For example, traffic from each house in a neighborhood could converge at one of these boxes, which forwards it to upstream distribution centers like central offices and regional hubs. What's the point of this distribution layer? Well, it works just like the electricity grid. This kind of tree structure is basically seen in every segment of life. Everyone in a company doesn't report directly to the CEO, your driveway doesn't connect directly to the highway. Trees are just the most scalable structure of all time. And then finally, we arrive at the core layer, which processes the traffic and routes it to the proper destination. The CRTC made a helpful diagram of Rogers' core network. Going clockwise from the left, we see the red represents Rogers' main telecommunications network that all their customers use. The wireless network will consist of things like their cell phone plan or wireless home internet. If you recall, I'm a pro gamer, so my 8 gigabit per second fiber internet is part of this wireline network. Then, depending on whether or not you called 911, the traffic is routed to either the public alert service or the internet and other external network providers. But how does my Fortnite connection know the path to the core network? Well, that's where the Border Gateway Protocol, or BGP, comes in. So say we have a bunch of routers in the distribution layer between me and the core. Each router maintains a list of routes they know, which are pathways for sending traffic to specific IP ranges. These IP ranges are formatted in what's called SATR notation. This is an IP address followed by a slash and a number from 0 to 32 called the prefix length. The max is 32 because IPv4 IPs are 32 bits, consisting of 4 8-bit numbers separated by dots. So we probably know what IP addresses are. It's like your actual address, but on the internet. By adding a prefix length such as /32, we represent the set of all permutations of the preceding IP when the prefix of 32 or first 32 bits cannot change or are fixed. If you do the math, we really have no options here since everything is fixed, so this is just one IP. On the other hand, /0 represents the set of all permutations of this IP when the prefix of 0 or none of the 32 bits are fixed. We are now free to set any of the IP bits as whatever we want, so this range includes every IP that exists. If you do the math, for IPv4 IPs, this is around 4 billion. Now, 16 means that the first 16 bits are fixed. How many IPs are in this range? We are free to set the last 16 bits, so doing some simple combinatorics, we have 2 choices for the first bit times 2 choices for the second bit, and so on for 16 times. This would equal 2 to the power of 16, or around 65,000. You may notice by now that the size of our block is just 2 to the power of 32 minus the prefix length. Anyways, the entire internet can be subdivided into these blocks of IPs, and BGP is what is used to find the best paths to connect these blocks together. Going back to our route table, an example route might be to reach this set of IPs, send traffic to this next router. Basically, BGP consists of routers advertising the routes and route attributes they know to their neighbors, who then do the same thing to their neighbors. So in this way, everyone gets the updated navigation directions to reach every IP address that needs to be reached, and everyone is happy. The neighborhood nodes we talked about before will, for example, know the specific routes to the home networks in the neighborhood. Its routing table may look like this, with subnet information for specific customer home IPs. But the core network and upstream hubs don't need to know information this granular, so it obviously makes no sense for every single route in every router to be communicated to the core. Therefore, 2 techniques are mainly used to improve BGP efficiency. Firstly, routers can aggregate routes by merging multiple small ranges into a larger IP range. For example, 14 home networks can be aggregated into a single /28 route. More importantly, routers are configured with filters that selectively control BGP routes that are advertised and received. In the case of Rogers, they used access control lists, which match particular IP prefixes. This way, the upstream routers only receive routes that they need to know. However, interesting things can happen if you accidentally delete these filters, say for a significant portion, if not the entire distribution layer. On the day of the outage, Rogers was performing some maintenance to upgrade their core IP network in a 7-phase high-risk process. But after the first 5 phases were completed successfully, they figured the maintenance was actually not that high risk and downgraded it to low risk. So during this phase, they originally intended to clean up some configuration files, but instead accidentally deleted the access control lists for what is assumed to be the entire distribution layer. After the finger slip, Rogers' core was flooded with routing information from the downstream routers. Since the core routers were not configured with proper overload protection mechanisms, the excessive routing data caused them to crash within minutes. Soon enough, user traffic can no longer be routed to the appropriate destination, causing services like mobile, landline, internet, and 911 calling to cease functioning. Rogers' core network was also responsible for advertising its routes to the open internet. Everything I talked about before was internal BGP or IBGP within Rogers' own network. External BGP or eBGP is essentially the same thing except in the open internet. But you need to be important enough to have an autonomous system number to play the eBGP game. Rogers, for example, is assigned AS812, Google has AS15169, and McDonald's has AS22292, though they don't actually use it for anything. Since Rogers' core routers crashed, they ceased advertising eBGP routes to their friendly neighbors on the internet and eventually disappeared, reminiscent of Facebook in 2021. So the reason why it took a really long time to fix was because, as you'd already expect, everything broke and their critical infrastructure sites did not have redundant connectivity from alternative service providers. Not only could they not connect to their infrastructure, the staff also could not connect to themselves. Rogers' staff used Rogers' mobile and internet services, so they were not able to communicate effectively during the early hours of the outage. Lastly, lack of documentation of the low-risk maintenance may have slowed the investigation, as they cannot pinpoint the root cause for about 14 hours from the start of the outage. given the network saw recovery about 15 hours in, most of the time was actually spent on determining the root cause rather than fixing the issue. So besides remediating the above issues with proper overload protection and improving their risk assessment algorithm for maintenance changes, Rogers has decided to separate the IP core for wireless and wireline networks. They plan to spend $261 million to physically rip them apart. This will resolve the single point of failure seen in this outage and will allow for one network to stay up as long as they don't perform the same catastrophic maintenance event in both networks at the same time. Runbooks, well-defined roles, alarms, automatic rollbacks, communication protocols, third-party providers for backup, AI, they got it all figured out now. All it took was a somewhat pricey outage.